basically in a way.
Who gave it to you? I mean, who was the...
I saw the Ramones on Don Kirshner's back in October 77, and that's what I waited for all my life.
That was like midnight on a Saturday night or something, right?
It was Wednesday night. I had to go to school the next day, and it was on at about 2 in the morning because we're an hour behind, and it was cable from ABC during the States, eh? And that's what I waited for all my life. I knew it when I heard the Ramones that night. It blew me. I was into music before that. I even had a band before that. My first band goes back to 74 called Purple Night, but...
And they're still together.
Purple Night? Purple Night,
yeah. Yeah.
Not named after the Moncton High School football team.
No, because I was 9 at the time, and it was named after our Deep Purple song called Black Night, but we changed to Purple because we love Deep Purple and blah, blah, blah.
Were you born with a drumstick in your hand or something? Almost. You were 9?
Yeah.
But do you come from a musical family?
Very much so. My father played famous jazz bands around Moncton, and my brothers toured a lot, and so we're kind of a musical family.
Yeah. Well, what is it? How did you know? When I hear your music, it seems like there's the two tracks we just listened to, right? The first one is so much different from the second one. It seems like there's a willingness to be open to different ideas and to different kinds of music, and not necessarily to just play, I don't know what.
Rock and roll.
Yeah, or grunge or whatever. I mean, there's a refusal to be categorized into one thing or another. And there's a couple bands around that are into that now that I think who are almost perversely trying to make music that's so different, where each track the tracks that follow each other are different enough to challenge people into saying, hey, you can't categorize us. What is it that gave you the idea that you could be that brave with the stuff that you put down on disc?
I don't know.
I don't think we really thought about it. Yeah.
We tried to have the songs to be the same, but we...
Well, we write all the songs acoustically anyway, so we know that...
They're all wrote really folky and kind of mellow, and then at first, when we had our other drum, we just tried to play them really, really loud and slow, and like playing folk kind of songs loud and slow with me and Julie doing harmonies and stuff. And then when we got Mark, it all kind of came together a lot more, where... They sound more like, you know, like Smother instead of Blue Sky for Julie, mm-hmm. you know, as much live.
Well, is Blue Sky for Julie an earlier song or something?
It's kind of a bit older. Well, it's like
not that. Yeah.
Last year.
We just recorded it.
These are an example of the harmonies we're getting here right now.
We just recorded it in like February.
Yeah, we just recorded it, but it's an old song.
Yeah.
The Nevermind the Mollusks thing, of course, has been written up. You mentioned that, right, Chris? That there's a lot of things written about you that maybe people have heard about you from press before they actually heard your music.
Yeah.
And this has been written up, of course, because this is the first Sub Pop thing that you've done.
Yeah, right.
Okay. Why did you say no to Sub Pop first? Because that's what happened, right?
Yeah, I guess just because of the offer we got.
It was an okay offer, but... We just thought we would be better off on our own.
Staying independent. Like, compared to the offer, we thought, well, it'd be funner to just stay the way, you know, we were almost.
Because that's what we had no intention, really, of... Like, we had thought of maybe, like, looking for a label, and then when we really talked about it, we decided not to, and then that came up after.
And then the King of Nut came back to us, and it was starting to look better, so we went with it.
Yeah.
We wanted, you know, Sub Pop was a good... If any label, you know, it was a good one kind of for us, because they're letting us be really free and record in our basement and... You know,
there's no
like
restrictions
that.
Really with
stuff
them.
Like that. Because when we played Vermont and we met Bruce and Jonathan of Sub Pop, they kind of asked why we passed on the deal at first, and I just said we're very scared. We saw all these big words in the contract we had never seen before. We felt like we were going to be owned, and he said, "Okay, wait a minute. You guys are in the driver's seat, and it's something like that." So we asked all the questions about our own, you know, paranoias and stuff like that. And they said, no, we're not going to own you and all this. And so that kind of like made it more tarped out for us that the fear factor went down. And we said, okay, I think it'll be a good home.
Yeah. Meeting them helped a lot.
Really?
Yeah.
You met them at Vermonstrous?
Yeah.
Okay. What was it that, how did they reassure you in person that they weren't like sleazy lawyers in suits and that kind of thing?
Yeah, exactly.
It was weird.
It seemed like they really, you know, liked us. They kind of, when they talked to us, it didn't seem as much like they were these, you know, shifty people. They kind of seemed like they actually might have liked us.
It was weird because when we were playing, really I saw Jonathan in the audience and he wasn't too far back. He was like in the middle and he was kind of not really dancing that much, but he was like kind of into it. And that was kind of weird.
Did you know who he was? Or did you just
I had met him like before I had met him, but he forgot who I was, I think, because then I saw him the next day and he looked at me and didn't really, but then he knew I was after.
He just thought you were another crazed Screaming Trees fan or something.
Yeah.
You mentioned recording at home. Is that an important thing for you? Is it the fact that you can take control of things better maybe from your basement? I mean, why a home recording thing?
It's more comfortable.
Yeah.
More personal.
We really kind of want to be in control of the whole sound of the recording, not for like, not, I don't know, just we don't feel comfortable in studios because we don't feel like we have the time to really get these, you know, right moods and stuff.
Yeah.
We really like I think recording is a really personal thing, and if I record it with some other producer and stuff, it doesn't seem as much like mine. It's like we just kind of gave it to him to kind of screw around with it.
Yeah.
Well, Peter is a very, I mean, the EP that comes out on Murder Records, that's available on Murder Records, is a very eccentric sounding record. By that I mean, you know, eccentric in a good way.
Yeah.
But it doesn't sound. It isn't. There's voices that kind of bleed from track to track. There's there's peculiar noises that come in between the tracks. It seems like I was wondering whether I was supposed to be hearing what I was hearing on it or not.
Yeah, a lot of it's really
sometimes
natural.
There are mistakes. So, like, I mean, sometimes it's things that just kind of came in by. Like wasn't deliberate, but
doing vocal overdubs with the TV on and stuff in the background. Like it's not ghosts. We didn't stick them in, like we didn't overdub those samples. They just kind of accidentally get on, which
you
is
mean you forgot to turn off the TV?
Or well, we just leave it on, like, because it gives a great mood that we liked. When we listen to our record, it's nice to hear stuff like that instead of listening and hearing. Remember that studio? You
know? It seems like
remember that TV show when
if
it was
Peter
on?
If Peter would have been recorded in a studio, it would have sounded so much more clinical.
And we tried it too. We tried to record in a studio, and we didn't like the way it turned out.
So why?
We really rushed it, I think, too. We did it all in one day.
Too.
Yeah.
The magic came out when Rick recorded it down his basement, not when it was done in a studio in Halifax. It was fine in Halifax, but I find Rick brings up the magic more of the band.
We're slowly getting better at it, too, at finding what we want, kind of.
Yeah. He can do stuff with doing. A four track that.
I'm recording all like every Moncton band now to practice. So
to practice on them, to experiment on them, maybe.
Well, like. No, to record them, and it gives me more help when I go to record us. Like every time I record a band, I know more. So.
And you don't find that. I mean, you actually think that the limitations of the four track are more challenging than you know doing something on 16 track where you can have like one fader for the tom, one fader for the left tom.
Yeah, it's kind of like old recordings, like old Beatles recordings, which I really am into. Like even like on the Smother song, we didn't record that at my house, but we produced it like an old recording with the drums in one, and just because I thought it was the best we could do in a big studio. We didn't have our own little stuff.
It almost sounds...
We're trying to get an 8-track right now, but I think that's the most I'd ever want to go.
What's your favorite part of Peter? What do you think is the strangest, most peculiar, and therefore most wonderful part of the new record, Peter?
God. I like a lot of the... I like in the song Deeper, the acoustic song that Julie sings, the TV in it. I find I can't hear it unless I really... don't think about it and notice there's a TV on in the room.
That's the one with the violin?
No.
The one at the end.
Deeper's like the last one.
I didn't know there was a TV on.
Yeah, really,
I mean, the record has enough going on in it that I thought if I asked you each this question, you'd come up with a different answer.
Yeah.
What about for you, Julie?
I don't have a copy of it. I don't know.
Okay, I'll lend you one of mine afterwards.
Yeah.
What about for you, Chris?
I haven't heard it in so long, I don't really
remember. Yeah, see, none of us...
We got it done last October, and we've been waiting for it to come
forever.
All right, well, we'll take a track from Peter now, and then we'll be back. This is called Tangles.
Okay.
Doug about her, suddenly oh.
next trip. From Peter, that's called Tangles. And my guests tonight are Chris, Rick, Julie, and Mark from Eric's Trip. So this song was actually released before on one of your cassettes, right?
Yep, on our last cassette, home-taped kind of cassette that we put out before our 7-inch single.
Yeah. The fourth one.
Our first one with Mark playing drums. We had another drummer before that.
Now, I remember we talked to you once before when you were, I think you were in Halifax, right? I don't remember if I asked you whether, when you named yourselves Eric's Trip, if you thought you would ever be opening for Sonic Youth.
We never thought we worried about that, actually.
Yeah. But they seem to be, they didn't care, huh?
Yeah, Lee Ronaldo, it's his song, and he said it was totally fine with him.
Yeah.
So
he almost changed the name of the band because of that.
We were thinking of some, too.
Some bad ones, but
yeah.
We try to think about a new band name, they all sound stupid.
Call yourself Cool Thing instead.
But even our 7-inch that we put out when we sent it to get pressed, we didn't even put the name on it because we didn't know what name we were gonna take.
So we had to write it on
everyone.
I have to ask you this because it seems like every scene now in North America is being sold as a piece of geography. You know, like there's a San Diego scene now, there's a Minneapolis scene, there's a Chapel Hill scene, and in some ways the maritime scene is being sold more successfully as a kind of geographical scene than anything else, because I've seen it written up in like Sassy and Spin. It's been written up in a lot of national publications now. And first of all, do you think it's going to stick? Do you think it can continue to work? It doesn't matter.
It's not like a city scene. It's like a great big area.
It's like four provinces.
I think there's going to be a Canada scene or something.
It's weird. It's really scary to think that they're even calling it that. Like, there's always been stuff going on there. Like, punk and stuff in Moncton. I don't know. It's a shame that...
interest will still always have the great bands happening. It's been going for 13 years now in Moncton.
It'd be a shame to think the attention came, you know.
As bored as people are with Seattle maybe now, there's still a lot of probably good bands starting there.
But the problem, of course, is that a lot of bands go to Seattle thinking, well, we want to be a Seattle band, right?
I don't think anyone's going to come to Moncton.
Some band, I can't remember.
Going to Halifax?
Yeah, they're moving to Halifax because of all the
really?
Hype going around.
Yeah. Oh, jeez. It'd be a shame to think that all the hype would come and then go and then nothing would happen like that. Like, it'd be nice to just have people know that there is stuff going on there and that there always has been and that there will be.
It's not too big. I'd hate to see it get out of proportion.
And it's a varied scene, too. There's so many.
Yeah, there's lots of variety.
There's no real set generalization to it.
Maybe that's the good thing.
There's always been great bands out of Moncton.
The good thing is there's not one city and it's not one sound, kind of. They're all kind of.
We're originally known for like Celtic music in the Maritimes.
Oh, yeah. Tons and tons of that. That and blues, as I said earlier. When I used to hitchhike a lot in the Maritimes. Is there still hitchhiking going on there?
Not with us.
I'd be terrified.
Would you pick somebody up if they were hitchhiking?
If we knew them.
I think not. I don't know. Rick's brother-in-law picked up someone they half knew once and he got stabbed by him.
Somebody he half knew. Yeah, but
like,
that was probably
they knew who he was. I don't know. But I mean, just when you hear things like that, I'd be too afraid to pick someone up. But it's hard to say.
Rides in the storm.
Yeah, if it was like, Tara or something, whatever.
So if you're not playing a gig on Saturday night in Moncton, what do you do for fun?
Go to the mall.
Which mall?
Champlain Place.
What happens at the mall? That doesn't happen at malls all across North America.
It's the largest
one-level mall east of Montreal.
Where's the largest two-level mall east of Montreal?
Halifax.
Yeah.
Dartmouth.
And really, you can still hang out at the mall and have a good time?
Yeah, and Mark works there, too.
They took our favorite bench away because we always sat on it.
They should put a plaque on that bench, for God's sake. It's the Eric's Trip bench.
They said we were ruining the
tree.
They don't
appreciate us.
Yeah, I don't know.
I was wondering if 20 years from now, there'll be like the Eric's Trip reunion on the Ralph Ben Murgi show, you know? tonight he'll be saying the original members of Eric's Trip will get back together and perform, you know, songs after their solo careers. But what is it that, you're signed to a fairly high-powered independent label, and you talked about how you think that label will allow you to pursue the things that you want to pursue.
Yeah.
How far can you go with this? I mean, how big can it get?
I don't think we really want to get that big anyway.
We'd like to be more, I don't know.
We just want to Just play.
Well, I'd rather be popular on a smaller scale than popular on this big scale.
Yeah, yeah.
But Sloan, who are friends of yours, obviously, and who signed to Geffen and are doing very well, you can see what pressures or what it does to them to be doing what they're doing, going through what they're going through. Do you also see what's good about that? Is there anything about that's attractive to you?
Not really. No.
Really?
We just want the best of both worlds. We like to have our old lives intact, just being dumb kids hanging in Moncton. But to get a little bit of recognition with the bands that we're in, instead of always having like one or two people show up or 20 or whatever, is nice too. So we'd like to just go for like having our little band and kind of being liked and maybe, you know, minorly successful. And then still have...
We don't want to be stuck in a van for like 4 months at a time.
Yeah.
So we don't want to give up for music. We'd still like to have the best of both worlds, our own home lives, plus to be in the band too. And so things have been so good.
Sloan got a super van.
Yeah.
In Europe, they had a super van with beds and TVs and VCRs and the van. Okay.
Well, maybe selling out is worth it.
No,
I'm not saying that they sold out, but
they got a nicer van than we did.
Yeah. well, I mean, a lot of bands, people like Firehose and the Minutemen, and, you know, I mean, the touring is part of the ethic for them, and being able to get from one place to the next quickly and efficiently, and then setting up and playing a real blazing set is what it was all about, right?
Yeah.
So you know.
Oh yeah.
Some bands are more road hungry.
You're not road hungry.
I'm not yet.
You're a homebody.
Yeah. I get homesick all the time.
Yeah.
We've been gone for 2 days and we're like,
When Mark first came with us, he wasn't even planning on playing out of Moncton. When he first joined, he said it was only supposed to be temporary, remember? Yeah. And it was just, he decided to do a couple shows, and then our first show in Halifax or Fredericton.
We just loved his drumming so much. We kept trying to convince him. Like, we made him stay.
And there's a magic to the band too that definitely kept me sticking around. I couldn't, you know, usually every other band I had, I ran. It's the first time I've been in a band as just a drummer, but I don't know. There's something about Eric's trip music.
You're playing that music.
What is the quietest song you play? Can you describe to me how quiet you let yourselves get? Because that's the dynamic is the thing that I pick out here, that you can be incredibly loud, and then at times it's very,
live?
Very...
The raw energy quiet. Track is a good representation of something quiet.
We're not playing it, right?
Deeper off Peter.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Like, when we play Understand Live, that's really quiet.
A lot of my solo stuff, like, is really quiet, and I guess that's what... You always need that, I guess, when you're playing in a loud band.
But do you do it live, too?
We do Understand Live.
We've done it, but that gets loud, too.
Yeah, that's, but it's basically
it's like an extreme
quiet.
One. Extreme.
I'd like to do tango.
And how does that go down in a club when you do that? Like when you go for those extremes? I mean,
I think it scares people sometimes.
It's
really?
Weird, yeah.
Some songs just start out so quiet, and then all of a sudden it just goes way, way too loud for them.
Yeah.
You're not expecting it, but I think it comes across pretty well.
Yeah, we played in Halifax once, and Laura, one of our friends, our last three songs, she said she was just... she's in a trance. She said for the last three songs
when you play
of our
quiet,
set.
It kind of gets,
I thought that was
kind of
nice.
Really
I didn't.
Do, you know? You hear all the drunk people, you know, talking. You can actually hear them while you're playing because it's so quiet. And
but not always. But then, that's what's weird. Sometimes they really pay attention.
They're not always screaming rock and roll.
Yeah. It's kind of nice.
That's not even people making feedback for us.
Yeah, they're really they're making noise in the audience.
Okay. Did you bring your violin on the road with you?
No, but I'd like to try to do that song live.
Yeah,
we've
never
we'll
done
try
Tangles
it. Probably.
Live.
Yeah,
I don't know if I can redo it. That was such a spontaneous thing.
And once we played at the Dell Green Room in Halifax, and there was a violin on stage.
Yeah,
and I said,
we were tempted.
We almost did Tangles Live.
So. Somebody left them. That's an omen.
No, yeah, well, it was for the other band.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, it was sort of
an omen.
What's next? I mean, the Never Mind the Mollusks is just coming out now. The Peter EP is available on Murder Records. Never Mind the Mollusks is the Mollusks. That's hard to say.
I know.
Why did you say Never Mind the Clams or something?
I don't know. We didn't.
That's not the Sub Pop. Never the Peter EP is on Murder Records. Do you have other stuff up your sleeve that we don't know about that we will soon?
In April.
There's a single coming out in like a month. Our first single on
Sub Pop.
That's four songs.
Yeah, into the 4-track EP.
Are you going to be able to drag Mark out on the road again after this tour is over?
Yeah, we
looks
have to.
Looks like
we're
it.
We're going out, I guess, for a long time.
In the U.S.?
Yeah. Some in the U.S. I think we're touring with Pond. So.
Pond and Six Finger Satellite, probably.
That sounds like a great bill.
Yeah, that'll be fun.
I hope so, yeah.
That's what it's supposed to be right now.
And there'll be some rock and roll bonding going on.
Yeah.
Eric's trip has been my guest tonight. Thank you. It's nice to meet you all.
Thanks a lot.
Eric's trip from Peter. That's called Listen. And Eric's trip are touring across the country as far as Kingston anyway. They'll be Guelph March 17th at Trashateria, Windsor the 18th day of March at the Masonic Temple, and London on the 19th, Promised Land, the Rivoli in Toronto on Queen Street, March 20th, the 21st in Hamilton at Downstairs John, 24th in Waterloo at Phil's, 25th in Ottawa at Zaphod Beeblebrox, and a date in Kingston to follow. And Eric's trip were my guests tonight in studio.